So now we have Frederic Heron, who will talk to us about political inequalities. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation. This is a very nice workshop, So I'd like to show you, in fact, which seems to be a lemma in a big program we have with some colleagues. I will give the name after. And where it appears that we need a functional inequality, which is of Korn type. So I will explain why is Korn, why a Korn type inequality. And at the end, perhaps explain why it appears naturally in some kinetic problems when you have a big external potential in a homogeneous kinetic problem. So this work, that's the title for us. So I will explain, in fact, the two names, white corn and one left in here. This is a common work with Carapatoso. This will be first an introduction about Korn, let's say Korn. And after that, some elements of the proof. I think I would like to give you a very, very simple toy model kinetic example, but definitely it appears to be necessary. So, introduction to Korn, what is Korn? This is something like this. You take, let's say, omega in Ord, smooth, bounded. And on omega, you take a vector field. U. And for many reasons, you physical reasons, I think at least in the field I know, the natural quantity that appears in estimates, if you want to do quantitative estimates, is the gradient symmetry. You may think, for example, like elasticity problems, and also in the study of kinetic equation, what you have, you do the computation, you do, for example, the macroscopic equation, and what appears is gradient symmetry. And of course, for functional reason, what you need in order to close estimates is gradient of U. Okay. Get some compacity or some full estimate or use some Poincaré inequality later. You need the full gradient. So the natural question is do you have something like that? And this is Korn inequality. Do you know how to bound? Gradient of U by gradient symmetric of U. Perhaps I recall what is gradient symmetric of U first. A gradient symmetric of U, this is a matrix made of, let's say, gradient of U. Transpose. over two. So this is really the symmetric part of the matrix, because gradient of U is a matrix. The symmetric part of gradient on the course is the commutator part. U minus U. So the problem is you get in your computation, you get gradient symmetric of U, and you want to have estimates like this, or if you have an estimate like this, thanks to Quark, you will be able to close your estimate. So in fact, I give you a first theorem, which is due to Quark in O6, which is that if you suppose that U is equal to zero on the boundary, and U has some sufficient regularity, okay, let's say H1, then indeed this is the case. Thanks to the rigidity imposed by the boundary, you effectively have gradient of U in omega less than anything else to square L2 omega less than 2 gradient symmetric of U square. Okay. So I can give you the proof of this. Because this is in fact a very easy proof in two or three lines. This is due to some algebraic problem, algebraic computation, so proof. There is an equality, so the equality is the following. This is gradient A U squared, you suppose that U is sufficiently smooth, plus divergence of U square plus divergence of U minus U scalar grad of U is equal to gradient symmetric of U. So if you want, you can do the computation on your sheets. This is just computation. You use many times the Schwarz-Lemma. Okay, so this will be an equality. Each time U is smooth. Okay, this is an equality. And what you do is you integrate. You integrate, and when integrating, you remember that U is zero in the boundary. So using Stokes on this formula, it tells you that in fact the integral of this is zero. Okay, you see there is a U here, by integration by part, and there is also a U here, so this term disappears, and this gives you essentially that you have a gradient A U square plus divergence U square is equal to gradient symmetric of U square. Okay, so this is a simple inequality, and this is strongly related to the fact that U is null at the boundary. And there is a second very simple computation, which is related to, let's say, the orthogonal decomposition of gradient in this symmetric and antisymmetric part. Which tells you that I directly what is the norm, that gradient A U square plus gradient symmetric U square fact, this is the full gradient. Gradient Q squared. So of course you have orthonormality behind this. And so you look at this. Let's say it's a 2. Here 2, 1. And you see that apart from the term divergence, you are able to find exactly what I said, gradient symmetric, gradient of u squared is in fact less than 2 gradient symmetric. Okay. In fact, there is an equality here if you want the divergence. Okay, so the talk is finished now. Thank you very much. Of course, this is not a real problem that appears when you look, for example, at your preferred kinetic equation. When you look at the kinetic equation, let's say, for example, looking at the macro equation related to some boundary problem with specular condition. In real problem, say, we only have u scalar m is equal to 0. We do not have u equal to 0 at the boundary, but we have just u scalar m, which is that there is, for example, in this case, you look at something like this, this gives you that u, that is the moment. The integrate of f v with respect to v, f is the density of probability of presence. This gives you that. So, if you look at this proof, it breaks down because of one term, which is essentially this one. Okay, you see, of course, this one it will be okay because when doing the Stokes formula, there will be a u scalar and appearing, but in this case, there is no u scalar n. U has been modified, turned, and the proof breaks down. Okay. So how to do this in that special case? So in fact, this was done. So the previous piece doesn't work. And in fact, this is okay. It's okay in fact. Let's say not with the constant 2, with 2 replaced by some other constant, ck. And it was proved by Villani and Desilette in, I think it was 02. And I should mention that it is not the same century that Cole, okay. Cole, this was in the 19th century, and Villani and Desilette more recently. So they show this, and in fact, it was a little paper that appeared at this day, which was part of essentially the same general problem of, let's say, return to equilibrium. In fact, it was used in an already paper, quoted paper here about coming to the equilibrium for Boltzmann, algebraic time trend to the equilibrium for Boltzmann equation. So, in fact, I have to precise perhaps the theorem. This is true, but you have to assume some things, and in fact, in this talk, I will only focus on the case, and you will see why this is not so clear in the case when there is no axisymmetry of omega. When there is no axisymmetry. For omega, and perhaps it is a good idea to see a special case where it does not work and when there is symmetry. Partial multiple. So our aim is to do essentially the same, but in another geometry. Okay. Instead of looking at this problem in omega bounded, we want to, with the associated Lebesgue measure, renormalize Lebesgue measure equal to one over the measure of omega times the Lebesgue measure. We want to look at the same problem in the full space. Let's say, here, this was in omega with the measure of 1 over omega x. And I want to replace this by Rb with some measure rho of x dx, probability measure. And in fact, this problem appears naturally when you study the kinetic energy. So you want to give this. And in fact, you have to reinterpret all these kind of objects. For example, you see there was some, of course, the splitting of the gradient in its symmetric and anti-symmetric part is okay. But for example, in the first part of the proof there, you see you do integration by part, and integration by part in the bounded domain, so it gives you a boundary term. Now we are in another geometry, so what corresponds to an integration by part in this geometry? So it means essentially to, in this, okay, this is going from gradient to divergence. And here, again, you have gradient. And you look at divergence as the adjoint of the gradient with respect to this measure, apart from the boundary term. You see what is the natural the natural adjoint of the gradient. So this is not divergence because you have the rho. Okay? So I call it just divergence phi here. I think I put somewhere rho of x. I want this exponential minus phi. So the divergence phi, so I define it as the adjoint of the gradient with respect to this measure 4. In fact, this is the usual divergence. I think this is minus or plus, this is minus gradient of phi. Okay, if you try to do computation there, okay, you have to replace divergence by divergence phi, which is a natural geometric object. Okay, there is some geometry behind all this stuff. And now I'm able to give you essentially the theorem, or I don't know if it's a theorem or a dilemma. So, and indeed, you have what you mean, which is gradient of u. The thing you need to close your functional estimates is bounded by a constant, and I could put theta again, times the gradient symmetric of u, the guy you get when you look at macroscopic equation. And there is an additional term, plus divergence phi u squared. Okay. And again, there is some assumption, natural geometric assumption, which is in this version of the theorem, which is that phi is not axisymmetric. This means that, for example, x squared,
it's not a long
square, it does not work. In fact, more precisely, you have to quotient by all this kind of stuff. Okay. But in the case when phi is not axisymmetric, you have essentially what you want. So you may think that you lose something when in this you do not have divergence. And in this you have divergence. But perhaps it is useful to say that if you have here divergence, this is the same. And in fact, with or without is equivalent, just because divergence U is controlled by the symmetric part of U. This is just a trick. So in fact, this, you can put it or not, it does not change anything because this is controlled by this. So in fact, this is essentially the same theorem, but in an exaggeration. So I give you another example on take a long time for this, but in order just to have a flavor of what are the difficulties in this. So this is a counterexample. Counterexample, you take a phi which is dramatically symmetric.
So the main thing you may think about is phi of x is equal to, let's say, x squared over 2 in Rd or in R1, and you have to subtract a constant in order to that all is normalized. And you take u of x equal something very special. This is perhaps useful to have a hydrodynamic way of thinking. Think as u as the velocity or the moment of the fluid, and you ask that u is rotating. Okay, so this is related. U is related to the rotating moment, and so this is what essentially we call a rigid body motion. Okay, and sigma, this is just a matrix. Anti-symmetric matrix. Okay, so this is right to exist, these quantities, and you put them in the theorem. So I will show you that this theorem is false in this case. When you look at the gradient of u, okay, this is rather easy, you get sigma, which is non-zero. You look at the gradient symmetric of u. So this is sigma plus the transpose of sigma over 2, but since sigma is anti-symmetric, this is zero. And you look at the last term, which is divergence phi of u. So this is divergence here of sigma x. So this is divergence of sigma x minus, so the gradient of phi, this is x, and I take the scalar product with divergence phi. So you have to take the product with u, and u is sigma x. So the first term, this is essentially the trace of sigma, which is zero because sigma is anti-symmetric. And the second term, this is zero because you take x with sigma anti-symmetric. So all this kind of zero, which things are zero. And obviously, in this case, this is sigma, this is zero, this is zero, so this is false.
So why is this example enlightening? Because you see that this is not so clear how to prove such an inequality. In both cases, probability measure or Baldwin theory, it appears that you need to have an information, and perhaps I should say before, a quantitative information or a quantitative measurement of the non-accessibility of a domain. It is not so. It's not so clear. So I emphasize this point. Of course, all this in the general theory of a trend to the equilibrium of a kinetic equation, it was important. It was very important for us to have quantitative estimates, quantitative measurements. So here the problem is to get a constructive CK, which will have to take account the non-accessibility. I should also mention that there are constructive proofs that are very short, in fact, and the difficulty comes from the fact that we want to have a constructive CK. So I give you the proof, and I have to confess that essentially we followed, in many sense, we followed the proof of De Villette and Villani. And you see several natural objects appearing. So proof, elements of proof. You begin at attributing n square. I put an inequality, but this is an inequality in fact. It's dependent, of course. So this is the kind you want to buy. We can say u square gradient symmetry u square. So easy, this guy is okay. It is in the theorem, so you have to deal with the gradient anti-symmetric, and you already see that anti-symmetry seems to have a particular role. So one way to say that perhaps a good idea is to look at this quantity where this gradient U. Square is bringing symmetry of two squares. I just add by force this term, and this term, this is just the mean with respect to. Whatever phi is a vector or function. So there are three terms. There is I want to keep my order on my sheet. So this is T1, this is T3, and this is T2. Of course, this is a constant, but it's cool that we are in a probability space. So constant is of course equilibrium. And in fact, I could completely remove the double bar by a single bar. Okay. Which is a single bar, is a natural norm on the matrix. So T1 is okay. T3 is okay. T3 later, sorry. And let us look at T2. So T2, you see, this is a function without it minus its mean. So why did I do that? So it's because certainly there is a sort of Poincaré inequality. And it depends on the It depends on the communities, but in this case, when you look at the quantum inequality in a probability space, this is very often called Wittinger, and this is why we call it Wittinger. Okay, this is the Poincaré-Wittinger inequality. And I will call the Poincaré-Wittinger inequality just a view that represents A of U minus mean. Let's say this is square, this is less than the gradient of the gradient A of U. Square with something that we could call Cp, and this is the first quantity that appears, naturally, geometric quantity, which is a Poincaré constant, and in some cases, we find it's square, this may be one. And why it is it useful? This is because there is another simple tool, which is essentially the Schwarz-Lehmann. The Schwarz-Lehmann that tells you that in fact you can recover any second order derivative. UK from its symmetric gradient. I write the inequality. This is DI gradient symmetric of U. JK. So DJ gradient symmetric of U AK minus DK gradient symmetric of U. So this is an equality in general, so you see you have just inverted the order of derivatives, and this is an equality. But what it tells in particular that when you look at the norm A2 of this guy, it is essentially bounded by a big constant, a derivative of gradient symmetry. And in this sense, it means that this is in fact bounded by Cp, let's say, prime gradient symmetric of square. Of course, this is not exactly what we want. We don't want a second order derivative in the main theorem. We want just a gradient symmetric, not its derivative. So what we do is to use some refined Poincaré inequality without it has several names depending on the communities again. So some guy says that this is in some communities this is due to Elfer and Jostrand, in others it is due to Lyons. So there are many names. But this is just to say that I come back in regularity by putting here some things that I call omega minus one half. Let's say omega, this is essentially minus Laplacian in the flat case. So you decrease by one the order of the derivative. This is in RGB. And I recall, perhaps it is the time to recall, that of course minus Laplacian has a geometric sense, it is divergence. Okay, yeah. It's a minus. And this is in omega, sorry, with some boundary conditions. And when you look at this in RD, so I built exactly the same, the equivalent operator of this one, which is. I'm sorry, there is a collapse of notation. I will put a zero here. Okay, this is the omega, let's say flat. And this is omega zero. Yeah, so just omega zero is defined as the divergence of the gradient again. And this is, of course, the divergence adapted to the geometry. So it has a name, this sonata has a name, it has very, very good property. It is self-adjoint in particular self-adjoint, even if it's not too good, it is self-adjoint in L2 with a major group. Okay? And in fact, you can build a full theory, HS theory, adapted to this special this special Laplacian. And in fact, in geometers, this is called the Witten Laplacian. Okay, in particular, this, you see, you take the greatest, or you increase the level by one of regularity, or we decrease it, and this makes you come back in, thanks to this fashion, you come back into L2, and with this thing you can get the result for the term T2. So T2 is okay. So remains what may seem to be the easier term, which is just mean. This is a constant matrix that you evaluate in in the probability space. We are putting this list here, and I also have to mention so far that we did absolutely not use the axisymmetry condition. So certainly non-axisymmetry will be used here, and we see how. I'm supposed to finish by
14. Yeah.
14. So in 10 minutes, 11 minutes, right? Okay.
Maybe we started like 5 minutes late.
Okay. Fast. So for convenience, because this is a constant matrix, this way I write this guy, gradient of U, anti-symmetric, which I take the mean, I normalize it, saying that there is a lambda, which is essentially its norm, and sigma, which is normalized. So sigma, of course, is anti-symmetric. So that if I just measure this thing, written A, so since sigma is normalized, this is just around the square. This is just around the square. So and what I say is that T3, in fact, so this is which is lambda square. This is less than lambda square. Another constant, which I call Cj, and J is for Grad number. So Cj. Gradient symmetric of V sigma, and I will define all the objects. And what I say is that I will explain what is this strange thing. And what I say is that, of course, in order to put this in reality, this has to be larger than 1. So, and what is V sigma? V sigma, this is a solution of an elliptic problem. V sigma, where V sigma is a solution of problem, which is, you know, a problem in gradient and divergence form. This is, you suppose, as a divergence of V sigma is equal to zero. We have seen that it, in particular, preserves the measure. And the gradient antisymmetric of V sigma is equal to sigma. So in fact, it doesn't apply. So is it, but in fact, this is an analytic problem. I don't want to go too long about this time, but this is an analytic problem of form gradient divergence on vector fields. You can solve it. So you get a V sigma. In fact, there is some condition for uniqueness of this kind of problem, right? At least apart from finite dimensional problem. And in fact, what I say when I say that, and this is a sort of lemma, if phi is not axis symmetric, then when I look at the minimum over all sigma normalized and V sigma solution of this of the gradient symmetric of V sigma. So the lemma says exactly that this minimum is not zero. It's not possible to have this minimum to zero. And in fact, this is CG and the lemma, this is to say that this is strictly positive. So of course, taking this for this sigma here, with the sigma coming from this definition, I use my general lemma. And I can say that, of course, Cg minus 2 times this square is greater than 1. So let's suppose that we have this lemma in we have this lemma and finish the proof. So in fact, I put this here, so to say I recall that this is lambda square. Okay, perhaps I put it inside. Okay, this is Cg. This is less than Cj minus 2 gradient symmetric of lambda V sigma square. And I cheated, I put by force again Cj 2 minus 2 gradient symmetric of Q square plus gradient symmetric of U minus lambda sigma square. So this is a term, this is okay for my theorem, because this is a gradient symmetric. And for this I can use perhaps I did not write it, the fact that in fact you have okay, you can bind this essentially by just by integration by part. I go quickly. This is this one. In fact, this is bounded by just algebraic computations. Gradient antisymmetric of U minus lambda to sigma square plus divergence square U minus lambda to sigma. Okay, so the fact that you can bind gradient sigma by gradient symmetric plus divergence is just an algebraic computation, which is true for all functions, and I apply it to this. So I finish my computation. So there is the first term here. Cg minus 2 gradient symmetric of U square plus, and I look exactly at what is this. So this is gradient antisymmetric of U minus So this is gradient anti-symmetric of Vesima, but the gradient anti-symmetric of Vesima, this is big sigma. This is, so this term, in fact, this is a lambda big sigma, but lambda big sigma, this is a mean. And the last term, I look at it, of course, divergence phi of this sigma is zero by construction of my elliptic problem. So that just remains is divergence phi u square. And here you recognize exactly a function minus its mean. And in fact, this is exactly term t2. And t2, we already worked on this, and we know that all these kinds, all these strings, all these things are less than this plus what I call CP second gradient symmetric u plus divergence t. So the proof is complete apart from this lemma. So I don't. Definitely not have time to explain you this lemma. I just perhaps want to explain that where does it come from? It comes from the fact that it uses when we follow the proof, we adapted the proof of Villani and Davidet. It follows from the fact that when you have sigma, you turn around in a very circular way. And this is for V sigma, or this is not for V sigma, this is for, let's say, sigma x. You have a rotation. And when you follow the semigroup generated by V sigma, this is not, you follow not circular line, you are modified because of the non-antisymmetry of phi on the tool. The CG can be measured just by saying that when you move, this is some kind of transport, optimal transportation arguments. When you move, you look at the difference of the image. It is, since the image are different, you have a quantitative estimate for C. So that's just what I want to say. I will just want to give a just application to the Phi model. This is very, very simple Phi model. So perhaps the step zero when you study trying to see equilibrium is to find equilibrium or equilibria. And so I show you a very simple example where it appears. So this is a kinetic equation, inhomogeneous. So you take d dx, and the phi of all these theories, this is in fact an external potential, dF. And for collision kernel, in fact, I take the simplest one. I take identity minus the projection of, let's say, the not 1, not 4, not 5, not 5, just 4 minus IF. I explain you if F, so this is the, let's say, R plus V U plus H. This is an orthonormal decomposition. In fact, this guy is H. And if you are troubled with this kind of inversion way of writing all things, I just say that you work in fact in L2, D rho, and in all this stuff, for my real density, I put something like the Maxwellian equations. Okay, and this is the F, and you look at the top model, which is a sort of super Boltzmann linear equation that we saw a lot of time. Okay, just not projecting on the first on the mass, but also projecting on the moment. So this equation conserves mass and moments, but not energy. You could add energy, but this is another problem. And you look at equilibria. So step zero of anti-the equilibrium, look at the equilibrium. So you suppose that dF equals zero. As usual in this kind of things, because of the self-adjointness of the positive property of the collision kernel, you directly take the scalar product and get H equals zero. The microscopic part of the density is zero. So in fact, you have F equals du. And you know that this is an equilibrium. So what you do, this is completely Iverson Iverson process. So you take the scalar product of, let's say, the equation multiplied by 1 with and this is the way you build all the macroscopic equation associated to this kinetic equation. And this gives you that, you look at this. So all terms disappear. And what only remains with 1, I think this will be dTf is 0. Okay, I don't remember anyway. This gives you, I give you the three quantities. This gives you divergence phi with 0. When you take with V, this is gradient of R is equal to 0. And we take with respect to, let's say, my this term over 2 minus 1, something like that. This is U. And this is, as in the beginning of the talk, what appears naturally when you look at the macroscopic equation, this is not gradient, this is gradient symmetry. Okay. So, the macroscopic equation related to several moment conserving equations, this is not gradient of U, that appears, but gradient symmetry. And of course, thanks to the theorem. This gives you that since divergence phi u is equal to u and gradient symmetric of u is equal to 0, this gives you u equals 0, f equals constant, so that you get exactly what you want, which is the only equilibrium in the maximum. Okay. So this is the reason why you do it, and in fact, in the whole project, we go one more step. Assuming the energy conservation tool, and you again, when you look at all this kind of stuff and the quantitative return to equilibrium, you need this kind of curve estimate, as in the case of the development of the video. Thank you very much.
Explicitly qualified the equilibrium, but it seems to me that it could also maybe be used to show the trench equilibrium at these kind of estimates.
The
trench equilibrium, the decay range?
Yes, of course. This quantity Cg or Ck appears naturally in the trench equilibrium. This is a natural quantity. And this is why we wanted, definitely wanted to be constructed. This is a natural quantity that appears in all, let's say, the hypocrosive scheme, generally. It appears naturally as Cp and principal, the CG, c'est ça, natural meaningful quantities.
Maybe this is a silly question, but in the end, you conclude that Mach 2 is constant and Mach 2 is zero, or are we missing something?
U is zero. U is zero.
But why not constant?
Ah, pass. I did not have time. You have a L2 equivalent called inequality. Okay. You remember when I use, in this part, I use. The operator that goes from, let's say, H1 to L2, you can do the same for the full core inequality. Okay, so there is an L2 inequality, and in fact, you can find U. Full, not U minus its mean, but U. Okay, this is different from the scalar case, since here we are in the vector case. In this case, I can do it.
In the inequality, you cannot take phi axis symmetric. But now, if in this equation you take phi axis symmetric, what happens in the conclusion?
So you look at, physically, you look at what appears. It means that you are in a complete symmetric. For example, it's a complete symmetric case. Mm-hmm. What happens is that there may be some rotating. Permanent rotating movements, which are essentially stationary states. And so if you want to get the result, and it appears in the core, you have to quotient by this conserved movement. Okay. And of course, the corresponding, I did not write it, but there is a corresponding core inequality, which is to quotient by all the axes of possible axes of symmetry of phi. So, you have to think about some natural Hilbert structure of this kind of object in the set of anti-symmetric cushion by it, and you get the result. And in your hypothesis scheme, it means that you, so okay, you have conserved movement. Okay, this is like when Google works, it's cushioned by all the stuff that could move. Okay. And after that, he showed that the remaining part are tending to the move, or tending to the maximum. Okay, so it's exactly the same story.
So, do you have any more questions? No, I guess we should, as well as thanking Frederick, we should thank Natalie and Aaron and Pasha for the very last conference. It's over. I don't know if you, but yeah. Thank you for watching again.